Good morning, everyone. I am Samarth Bansal. I am a data journalist for the Hindustan Times English language newspaper back home in India. And this is a paper that I'm working on with two of authors called PhD students, political science at the University of Tokyo. So, what we are looking at, as I think Gurdy mentioned in the introduction, that a lot of research on social media is issue based. To politicians, and in our conversation when three of us met, we wanted to take it a step forward, thinking about politicians too, but also the people that they follow, what they do. Just to illustrate the importance of this, let me give you one example. So over the past 1 year, there's been a lot of conversation around accounts with the Prime Minister of India and the Twitter. So we have seen instances where people claim that trolls and subjective government use politicians. But there are at least 30 accounts that the Prime Minister of India follows. We have followed around 1800 accounts on Twitter. There's clear indication of pro-like activity where the kind of words that are being used by the tweets or the kind of narratives that are in tech. That's not really very civil. Recently, last year, a journalist in South India was murdered because she was very vocal against Hindu nationalist groups. And one of the accounts that the Prime Minister of India followed had an extremely hateful, violent tweet that was put out. You know, that led us to be very curious about this thing about then the party said this, that you know, the politician cannot control what people that they follow tweet about. That's not in their control. But that is the question, right? That if you are following a Prime Minister of a country or a member of parliament, if they're following an account, what does that mean? Right? Is it encouraging certain kind of behavior? So that is like one broad thing. The second is that what politicians read on Twitter, that's like an important component of their information diet. So that they try to understand what's going on in the country based on what they look at in their social media feeds. So we argue that if the people that they follow is more diverse, that's an indication of their willingness to engage with a more ideologically diverse set of views, even whether they agree with it or not. So if you understand the nature of the account of people that the politicians follow, that can give us some insight about what politicians think about when they're consuming news on Twitter. So when we started this, the first question was to just figure out, you know, who is on Twitter. So we collected, so just for context, India has Indian Parliament has two houses, the Lok Sabha and the Raj Sabha. Lok Sabha, the lower house, has directly elected politicians, so there are 543 member parliaments. And based on our research, we manually went and looked up every member of parliament in Lok Sabha, and we were able to figure out 357 accounts of the total 543 Lok Sabha. So that is the sample that we are looking at. And we did some basic characteristics on first of all, who is on Twitter among these politicians. So I'll start with that. First, we found that age really doesn't matter. It's not a good predictor of whether you're on Twitter or not. Then we say party affiliation and education does matter. So for instance, party, you see this, again for context, this is the two major national parties in India, the Bharatiya Janata Party, which is the ruling party at the center, and the Indian National Congress. They have a fairly, these two parties, the first and the second. And they have almost a fair probability of their being on Twitter. But as you go to more state-level parties, it declines drastically. And then you also see, in terms of education, if you have not gone beyond class 10, this is the, you can see the probability of you being on Twitter. This is some background about politicians that are on Twitter. And again, just to give a sense of when you collected this data about politicians, this is the timeline of how when they created the Twitter accounts. So you will see that this is the time around 2014, which is when the last general election happened. So it starts in some a bit of, if you read this chart, right, it's the thickness of the bit shows that how many MP joined Twitter in that month. The red line is the BJP, the party at the center. The blue is the Indian National Congress, the major opposition party, and the green is ours. This is just background of the politician that we are looking at, the member of parliament when they join Twitter and their background. Now, next step, We found of all these 357 entities, they follow 95,638 accounts, all of which 36,980 are unique. And we collected Twitter limits you to collect just the latest 2200 tweets. So for all these 36,980 accounts, we collected the latest tweets that we could gather. And profile characteristics of all these around 36,000 accounts. So that is the data set that we're working with. It amounted to somewhere around 40 million tweets. And background characteristics of the profile accounts that qualified the following. Now, one thing that's the focus of this initial area of research was we wanted to classify every account on a political spectrum. So can we say based on the tweet history that so-and-so account was like extreme right, extreme left, or is neutral? How can we do that? And the motivation to do that is what I mentioned in the beginning. Can we capture the ideological diversity of the accounts that, or rather let me put it this way, of the social media Twitter feed of an Indian MP on Twitter? If we're able to assign ideological score, that could give us a sense of, you know, what are they really consuming on a macro level. So we used two approaches to to figure out this, place them on an ideological spectrum. The first one was looking at media mentions, and the second one was hashtag. So we had this corpus of text. Now we had to convert this text data to some dimension to assign a particular score. And we did some research on how this approach has traditionally been used. But for our purposes, we tried out something new. And so one is that when I talk about media mentions, so increasingly, at least, I am myself a journalist and a consumer of news, we see that there is some sense of partisan nature of coverage among media outlets, even if someone can argue that it's not very explicit, but in the way it is perceived and how your leadership is designated in the end, that reflects a very clear partisan nature of news. So what we did, we selected 30 prominent news outlets in India. They were like ranging from print, television, online media, and we classified, we assigned an ideological score to each outlet on a spectrum of minus 10 to 10. So minus 10 represents extreme left, and plus 10 represents extreme right. Now the way we did this was three of us independently gave a score to each media outlet, and then we did a interpolar coalition. So we had agreement of our score was 0.75, and where we had certain disagreement, we went back and forth, discussed it, and finally assigned a score to each media outlet. And after that, for every handle, if they had retweeted that particular media outlet, we took that score, added all of them, and took an average. So for instance, these are the 30 media outlets that we took. It's ranged in that spectrum. Again, it's the reason we took minus 10 to 10. It's not very, it's a very relative score. So you can argue that, you know, what does minus 3 really mean? So minus 3 in itself is not too much, but in relationship of this continuum scale, that thinking of a news outlet as a minus 10 is one extreme and 10 is extreme, where do they fall? So that is how we came up with this classification. And then we looked at hashtags. So in our entire corpus, we collected all hashtags, and then we looked at all hashtags that were tweeted at least 1,000 times. So it's like suppose I tweeted a news outlet which had a score of minus 10, then my second retweet was something minus 5 and something 3. So I say minus 10 plus minus 5 plus 3 divided by 3. So every mention, every retweet of a particular, we take it as one entity and take the average score. And that is what, that's our one indicator of So for hashtags, we do this. We take all hashtags that were used at least 1,000 times. So we got a sample of 4,000 hashtags, and this covers around 50% of all hashtags that were in our data. Again, for every 4,000, we coded every hashtag. So we used, it was two steps. One, initial scan, where we could, you know, egg it versus hashtag voting. That doesn't mean anything, right? It could be, yeah. So that was step number one. And then we figure out this range from scale of minus 2 to 2 to identify, again, minus 1 and minus 2 were towards the left, plus 1 plus 2 towards the right. And in the end, we had 415 hashtags that were openly part. These are some of the examples of, like we just picked randomly 30 of them, how we classify the hashtags. So you can see like something like I support ABPP, ABPP is a student wing of the Modi guiding government, and so we gave it 2. And something like Modi GSPC scam, right, that's minus 2 because it's extremely critical of the current government. These are the results. First of all, this is the overall ideological distribution. You will see that on the left is for the our scoring based on media outlets, on the right is based on hashtag. You will see there is overall rightward skew in our distribution because the underlying data in itself, as like the BJP, the ruling party, has the maximum number of MPs and they follow like, the most number of accounts. So naturally, there is this rightward skew. And then we look at with this predicted ideological score, how does so we then consolidated. So if you're following 1,000 accounts for every MP, we calculated what their distribution looks like. So we see that education and gender, if you look at the distributions, I mean, there's like total overlap. It doesn't kind of explain the ideological score. There's kind of the overlap. But when you look at party-wise distributions, you will see that in this chart, the red is the BJP, the green is the Indian National Congress, and others put them together. So you see that in this, our approach with the media outlets, you can clearly see there is a left-right divide among accounts that the BJP is following and the Congress is following. And what was interesting for us that we kind of get a very similar distribution when we look at our methodology based on hashtag. So if you think about it, both approaches in themselves have there's no direct correlation between giving an ideological score to a media outlet and then picking out hashtags and then giving it a score. But our distributions are pretty much the same. Right? You see a left skew towards the Congress MPs and right skew for the BJP MPs. So what we are thinking about is that there's something more underlying to some phenomena which we think is perhaps ideology, which can explain why we get these two distributions, which are very similar in nature. Even though the underlying method that we use to get the decision is very different. Now, we know that there are a lot of limitations to some of the work that we've done. So the one is the coverage. So when I said the handles that we're looking at, 36,000, 45% of the handles could not be analyzed because they were not retweeting any of those handles. That is, that data set was up. And with hashtags, we are missing 55% of the. But what we saw was the missing values. There was no bias in itself. So you can see these charts. This is about like a missing value. So the distribution is overlapping. So perhaps when you look at the accounts, the 45%, 55%, they are equally distributed across party lines. But that is one major limitation. And second, we are not accounting right now for the uncertainty in ideological scope. For instance, if you are in our media methodology, if you are 2 retweets of a particular outlet out of a total 10 tweets, and if you have 2 out of 100, then they kind of give you the same score. So that is something that we need to improve on because we're not capturing the ideology is the larger proportion of the tweets that you're getting. And this is a work in progress, and the work that we intend to do in the future is this, that we retweets in itself tell you, okay, they can tell us something, but you have to look at the actual URLs that are sharing and then getting out the movies and then looking at, you will get a much more authoritative understanding of what media outlets first they are actually tweeting and second the content of those articles. We could not do this because of a logistical limitation, because when we collected the Twitter data we got all those tiny URLs and in the end the URLs said we had to resolve them to get a full URL. That was computationally challenging. So that's a work in progress. Second, we want to get a second layer of a so right now in our social network, we have politicians and whom do they follow. But we want to go a step ahead, is that accounts that followers also follow. So we have done this for cabinet ministers of India, that we have two-layer network and that is something we are looking at right now. But we want to extend this to these 36,000 accounts. Again, because of Twitter's rate limitation, it becomes computationally challenging to get this data. But we are working on it, and again, that will also help us improve our media methodology. Because you not only know whether they're retweeting on them or not, but also it will tell us whether they're following a particular founder. And then within the network, what kind of interrelationships are going on. So that is something that we intend to do as we